Hallelujah. 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 Good morning, friends, family, strangers all over the world. Wherever you may be and this message reaches down unto you, I pray good tidings upon your life. I pray that God will continue to bless you, nurture you, grow you, challenge you, give you victory, encourage you in areas needed to promote healthy lifestyles, God. We thank you, God, for everything you do in our lives, God. For all of the provision, for the air, Father. For the sky, Lord. For the trees, Lord. For the atmosphere, for the land and the ground in which we walk on and play, Father. We thank you for our friends, our family, for our children, for our mothers, for our fathers. We thank you that you've given us someone, God, to grow with, to learn with, to cry with, to smile with, to laugh with. We thank you, Father, that you find us worthy, Lord, to give us another beautiful day to smile and to be challenged, God. Another day to be stronger, God, in you, God. Another day to exercise our relationship with you, God. To get us stronger and smarter and wiser, more loving, less judgmental, more effective in pursuing and doing the good work, God. We thank you for our jobs, for the minor and small finances provided, and even for the big, Lord. Teach us how to be grateful with and without, Lord. Teach us how to be rich in spirit, God. Rich in mercy, God. Rich in grace, God. Rich in friendship, forgiveness, God. Rich in love, God. Teach us how to love our children more effectively, more lovingly, Father. Teach our children to love our parents, God. To love us more, Father. Keep us on one mind and one accord. We thank you, Father, that you are faithful. Even when we are not, God, you still count us as your children, Lord, to show us and guide us and teach us, God. Even though we don't want to sometimes learn, God, even though we don't want to sometimes pray, God, even though sometimes we don't want to seek your face, God, and sometimes we don't want to be a good person, Lord. But we thank you that you never let us not be good, Father. You protect us, God. You keep us away from always being angry. You keep us away from always being mean. You keep us away from always being selfish. And you teach us how to love and how to give more generously, more calmly, God. You teach us how to listen, God. You teach us how to listen, how to observe, how to understand, how to perceive. You teach us how to practice. You teach us how to exercise. You teach us how to get smarter, God. Yes, Lord, to know you, to love you, to fear you is the beginning of wisdom, Lord. Let us obtain her, God. Let us get into your word, God, this morning. Let us get into your word all morning, God. Let us dwell upon you, God. You tell us that we must pray without ceasing, God. That we must pray without stopping, God. That we must pray, God, throughout our day-to-day lives, God. That we must always have you in our mind, even when we're struggling, even when we are confused, even when we are about to hit the lottery, God. Let us always keep you on our first temple, Lord. Yes, gonna set this here to a different tone here. Welcome everybody. Thank you once again for another beautiful Sunday morning, where we will be getting in the Word of God. Grab your Bibles. You know, if you don't have a Bible, it's important that you learn to have one and keep one. Life isn't about Dr. Seuss. It's about Dr. Jesus. Oh, you like that one, huh? I don't know where I come up with these funny jokes sometimes. But I think they're funny, right? It's all about, it's not about Dr. Seuss, but it's about Dr. Jesus. Right, in Spanish, that's Jesus, right? In some other language, we call him Yahshua. In some other languages, they have many names for the Son of Man, for Jesus, for Jesus, for Jesus Christ, the Messiah. But whatever his name is throughout the generations and throughout different languages, I tell you here today that let the language be the same, that it is God inside of you. It is Emmanuel. And when you cry to the Son of Christ, the Son of God, when you cry to Jesus, you're crying out to God. You can call him Yahshua. You can call him Jehovah. You can call him Yahweh. You can call him Jesus. You can call him Diosito. You can call him anything you want, but know that it is the connection between you and your Creator, you and God. There will be many wars, and there are, in this life, because of arguments like this on whose name is what and what's name is who, and who is the right name and what is the wrong name. You know what? Inside of you is God, the Son of God, Jesus, Jesus. You are the Son of Man. You are God's creation. You are his workmanship. Meaning you perform because God builds in you to perform it. It's just like if you build something in life, a video game, a control, a toy, or something in life. When you create something, you create it to work and to be good. And that's what God does in your life. You're his craftsmanship. You are in his hand as he makes you, as he builds you, as he strengthens you, as he gives you all the knowledge you need, because you are going to need it. God would not show it to you if you did not need it. See, a lot of us would love to not work, but we have to work. Because the culture requires us to bring in finances so we can pay to have life in the way that we have it. In rooms, in homes, we got cars, gasoline, things that are valued and are traded for your time. And even in this, should be a place of worship for God. The Bible tells us in the book of Colossians that whatsoever you do it unto God. You do it unto the Lord. Whatever you do, when you work at it like if you're working for God. When you're washing it like you're washing it for God. When you're being responsible for it, you're being responsible like if you're doing it for God. If you're listening, it's because you're listening, because you're doing it for God. Everything you do should be done for God. Doesn't mean you have to walk around saying, hey, I'm doing it for God. Hey, I'm doing it for God. No, it should be an internal thing because God is inside of you. You should know that what you're doing is because you're doing it for God. When you come to churches and you listen to the word and you listen to the, you're doing it for God. It should be inside of you. Neither should you have to tell anybody, hey, I am a person of God. God is calling you to be a light, an example. They will see how light you bright up in this world, but you will make the difference. So let's read today in the book of Luke. It's important you learn how to read your Bible. It's not Dr. Seuss, it's Dr. Jesus. And this is the source to all truth. Anything in life that you are seeking, God promises if you seek it, you're going to find it. If you seek it, you're going to find it. And hopefully you're seeking good things, because you want good, you want to be finding good things. Imagine you're searching for snakes and scorpions. Oh, you're going to find snakes and scorpions. They're going to come out and bite you, right? So God tells us that whatever we seek, anything in life that we seek, if we seek it and we put our heart into it and our faith and we seek it, we're going to find it. But God tells us that not everything that you seek is going to benefit you or prosper you. It might hurt you. Again, you might stick your hand down the wrong hole and the snake bites you. If you ask, God will give it to you. If you're knocking and you're curious and you want to see if it's good, well, your curiosity will be answered. Luke chapter 12. Because check this out. And in chapter 11, just to feed off of this message, it says, now it came to pass as he was praying in a certain place, when he sees that one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us how to pray, as John also taught his disciples. You see, and when I was saying earlier that you need to learn how to pray without seasoning. When you do it for God. If you're going to pick up this rock, you're picking it up for God. If you're going to build a family, you're going to build it for God. If you're going to create a game, you're going to create it for God. If you're going to create this, you're going to create it for God. You see, and when you do that, Jesus tells us right here how to pray. Because these things in life, as you pursue them, they will become more real to you than you really thought. Because first we think about it, and then we go do it. But when we go do it, sometimes it plays like we thought it would, like, yes. And sometimes it doesn't play like we thought it would. So Jesus teaches us how to pray here. He says, and when you pray, young man, young woman, pray saying, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. See, God is your Father in heaven. When you come to him, he says, call him Father. Call him Jesus. Call him Son of God. Call him Yahshua, call him Jehovah, but know that that name is hollow inside of you. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. You know, thank God that you have the ability to obtain today. That as you are in the kingdom, God is allowing you to be responsible for friendships, for family, for employment, for community, for a home. On earth as it is in heaven. Because when you go back to heaven, God is going to embrace you in his home. So you have to see right now on earth as it is in heaven, that you in the presence of God are home. But of course, how much better when you are present with him, both in body and in spirit. But you have to prepare yourself, because on the kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive our sins. You see, because you're not always going to do the good things. You're going to mess up here and there. But God doesn't look at your mess ups. He wants to ask for you to ask him for some more bread. But if you mess up, you have to remember that anyone that messes up to you, you have to forgive them. Because God forgives you. And in this life, you're going to live it. Forgive us of our sins, for we also forgive everyone who is indebted to us. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. See, he's telling us that there is a life abundance ahead of you. And in this abundance of life that he is going to hand you, make sure that you know that God is the source of it and that God loves you. And as long as you pursue good things, then God will give you every good thing your heart desires. He says it will be tough. There will be obstacles ahead of you. But know that hollow is your God's name. Amen. So let's get on to the text. First chapter 12, verse 1. In the meantime, when an innumerable multitude of people had gathered together, so that they trampled one another, he began to say to his disciples, first of all, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy. For there is nothing covered that will be revealed, or hidden that will not be known. Therefore, whoever you have spoken in the dark will be heard in the light. And what you have spoken in the ear, in the inner rooms, will be proclaimed on the housetop. And I say to you, my friends, do not be afraid of those who can kill the body, and after they have no more than they can do. But I will show you who you should fear. Fear him who, after has killed, has power to cast into hell. Yes, I say to you, fear him. See, don't fear anything in life. The only thing you ought to fear is God. And I would fear him like a father does, or like a son does a father. Like if I mess up, my dad's gonna yell at me. That's the good fear. Let me not mess up so my dad doesn't yell at me. That's the type of fear and love and respect that God is asking. Let me be cautious, Lord, as I get involved here. Protect me, God. God says, I got you. Also, I say to you, verse 8, let's jump. Whoever confesses me before men, him, the Son of Man, will also confess before the angels of God. See, you have to be proud to be a Christian. You have to be proud to be a man of God. You have to be proud to be a child of God. Yeah, you may not be the coolest right now, but you will be. Sometimes I think life is backwards. You were either not cool when you were little, then you become cool when you're big, or you're either cool when you're little, and then when you get big, you become not cool. I think that's how it works. But this is, again, these are my theories, but You're either cool right now, but remember later you're not gonna be so cool. Or you're not cool right now and then you'll be cool later, you know what I'm saying? And it's gonna be much better later, right? I would rather have it later. Let everybody enjoy everything and then let me just chill at the end, right? Relax and enjoy everything that God has allowed us to get. You see, I always like to use this theory that God will hand you an empty plate. He'll say, son, I'm going to give you this empty plate. And I know you're hungry. And I want you to fill it up right there with what you want. And then the devil comes with a plate that he has everything you probably could ever want. The devil says, yo, I'll give you all of this. All you have to do is enjoy it. And God says, I will give you none of this, but you are to fill it up so that you can enjoy it. Come on, Nate, you're dropping everything over there. Stand up, please. Help him out, Eden. You see, God wants to hand you an empty plate because the devil wants to give you a full plate. And if you sit there with the devil and eat all the food, what's going to happen? Anybody? You're going to get so full. You're going to get so big. You're not going to know how to work. And the moment the plate is empty, the devil's going to laugh at you. I'm like, huh, you silly man. Now you don't even know how to eat or how to go get the food to eat because you've been focusing on eating everything. And then God said, well, let me give you an empty plate. And I will put everything out there for you so you can go get it. And when you get it, you know how to put it back. That's Jesus, son. All right, go sit down. That's a good one. Good? You see how that works? The devil says, yo, I'll give you everything right now. And then when you're all eating it up, you lose sight on how to get it. That when it's gone, you only want it more and more, and you're willing to do whatever you can to get it. And sometimes it's not good. But if you learn from the beginning how to get it, then it's not going to be a struggle for you later. Because you started from the bottom, now we're here. Right? See, be proud. Also, I say to you, whoever confesses me before men, him, the Son of Man also will confess before the angels of God. See, I'm a man of God. I'll serve Jesus, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's the cool thing. I don't serve the NBA. I don't serve the NFL. I don't serve anything. I serve God. Also, I say to you, whoever confesses me before men, him, the Son of Man, will also confess before angels of God. But he who denies me before men will be denied before the angels of God. And anyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man, it will be forgiven. But him who blasphemes against the Holy Spirit, it will not be forgiven. Now, when they bring you to the synagogues and the magistrates and the authorities, do not worry about how or what you should answer or what you should say. For the Holy Spirit will teach you in the very hour what you ought to say. Son, you gotta chill, son. Come on. Sorry, I'm like full duty today. You know what I'm saying? I gotta do babysitter. The wifey got a job. We're trying something new. It's a little scary, I don't know, but I know God will pull us through. So, one day at a time, right? Tomorrow got its own worries. Today is enough, and we ought to be faithful with the day. So remember, be proud to be a man of God, a woman of God. Because in being proud, God tells the angels to pave the way for you, to make sure you're blessed, to make sure he sends every blessing you need. You didn't know how you were going to pay them bills. You didn't know how you were going to take these next 6 months. You didn't know But God promotes an angel in the outfield, which you don't see. And because you're proud to be a son or a daughter of God, God will bless you. He will never leave you. He will never forsake you. Son. For the Holy Spirit will teach you. See, sometimes in life, you may not have the answers. But it says, do not worry about the answers. The Holy Spirit will give you the answers. God will give you the answers. You just have to stand confident. See, he's telling you, when they're bringing you to authorities, when they're trying to belittle you, when they're trying to bully you, when they're trying to like make you think a certain way or something, don't worry about it. God is going to give you the right words to say so that you can have a good escape. Then one from the crowd said to him, teacher, tell my brother to divide the interest or the inheritance with me. But he said to him, man, who made me a judge of an arbitrary over you? Well, this is interesting. Then one from the crowd said to him, teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me. But he said to him, man, who made me judge or an arbiter over you? And he said to them, take heed and beware of covetousness, for one's life does not consist in the abundance of the things he possesses. I mean, that's a tough one. That's a situation where God's like, who made me an in-betweener of money? That's not what I come for. I did not come to make your matters of money and say who's right and who's wrong. Your matters of money are between yourselves. They don't prove God, and neither do they disprove of God. They'll either approve of you or not approve of you. I'm reminded of Jesus telling his disciples after the tax collectors came to the group of Jesus and his disciples and were like, yo, are you guys paying taxes over here? And they asked Jesus, yo, should we pay these guys their taxes? They're over here harassing us. Jesus says, well, whose picture is on the money? They said, oh, it's Caesar's. Well, then give Caesar what is Caesar's. Give to God what is God's. You give to Caesar. If Caesar's requiring a percentage of your finances, what are you going to war and destroy your chances of obtaining? Or are you going to give them the taxes and let them keep doing their community services, as they say? So he's telling us, be wise with your finances. Don't make money your trust and your confidence. Don't make money the reason why you can or you can't do something. If you want to do something, you should be able to do it no matter what. And when I say do something and do it no matter what, I'm talking about the good things of life. Then he spoke a parable to them, saying, the ground of a certain rich man yielded plenty. See, we see a farmer out there who planted some seeds. And he brought them himself, saying, what shall I do since I have no room to store my crops? So he said, I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build greater, and there I will store up all my crops and my goods. You see, so this man, he went out to go throw some corn. Let's just say, for example, some fruit. And he found that he had so much fruit. And imagine it, if you went out to go put some fruit in the ground and you got a whole bunch of fruit. What would you do with that fruit? You have this big old field of fruit and you got to do something with it. Because it's not going to stay out there all summer and all winter and all spring. So he's saying that this guy did that. This guy did that. He saw all this fruit, and this is what he said to himself. Well, I'm just going to build myself a bigger refrigerator. That'll work, right? He's going to get a bigger refrigerator so he can store all this stuff and let it go rotten instead of giving it back to the people. You see where his heart is? Instead of saying, you know what? I got so much of this fruit. Let me help people. Let me do something for people so they can eat fruit. Instead, the man said, you know what? This is all my fruit. I'm going to store it in my refrigerator. 1 month later, that food is already spoiled and rotten, and all them people are still hungry. It makes sense? So it's better if you have a lot, that you live a lot. Give, help, inspire. So he said, I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build them greater, where I will store all my crops and my goods. And I will say to my soul, you have many goods laid up for your many years. Take it easy. Drink and be married. But God said to him, fool, this night your soul will be required of you. Then whose will those things be which you provided? See, God's telling this man, you did all this stuff, built all this mansion, have all this wealth, have all this great things. But I'm calling for you right now. All that stuff is irrelevant. The moment God calls you is the moment all that other stuff could be irrelevant. Just like Job. When God called Job, Job got stripped away from everything, from finance to job to wife to family to house to car. He got sick in his body. When God was calling Job, Job was losing everything. You see, when God calls you, it's either you learn to say, it's not mine, it's yours. Or the moment God calls for you, what's yours, you might not want to let go when God is trying to show you something better. They say the weight of gold is on your wings and you can't fly. Well, let go of that gold so you can fly. So is he who lay up treasure for himself and is not rich towards God. See, you either store up for yourself treasures in here on earth. So is he who lays up treasure for himself and is not rich towards God. You're worldly more than godly. When he said to his disciples, therefore I say to you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat, nor about the body, what you will put on. Life is more than food, and the body is more than clothing. Consider the ravens, for they neither sow nor reap, which have neither storehouses nor barns, and God feeds them. Of how much more value are you than these birds? See, he's telling you here that don't make money in the pursuit of wealth be what builds you, but be a man of God that builds you, that when you receive the wealth, you know how to give back. Don't be the man that builds the wealth and then later does not know how to give back. Because believe it or not, even that man who built, to know not how to give back could be very damaging. You see, imagine I have all this stuff and I want to give back. I just don't know how to. People are just dying all around me. Things are just struggling. I want to give back, but I just don't know how. So I let people continue to die. That could be the most ugliest feeling in the world. See, it's better to build it. And when you get it, you give it. Because freely you have received, freely you are to give. Now, I'm not talking about a tithing message either here. That'll force you to put a couple of dollars in the basket. What I'm talking about is a tithing of the life. A willingness to believe that God is the source. And in your day-to-day pursuits, God will give you so that you can give back. He says, look at the birds. They don't go to work, clock in. They don't go to the bank and cash their check and then go into the grocery stores like, hello, we need food. The birds don't do none of this work. And God takes care of them. Aren't you more important than the birds? God is telling you. God is telling you that he will take care of you. That doesn't mean be lazy and do nothing. That means that you fly and you go and you look for your food like the bird does. And which of you by worrying can add one cubit to his stature? If you then are not able to do the least, why are you anxious for the rest? Consider the lilies. How they grow. We're talking about flowers. They neither toil nor spin. And yet I say to you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. If then God so clothed the grass which today is in the field and tomorrow it thrown into the oven, how much more will he clothe you? See, how much more is God willing to take care of you? Keep your heart on God. The Bible says, you of little faith, and do not seek what you should eat or what you should drink or have anxieties of mind. For all these things, the nations of the world seek after, and your Father knows what they need, these things. But seek the kingdom of heaven, of God, and all things will be added unto you. Do not fear, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Sell what you have and give alms. Provide yourselves money bags which do not grow old, and treasures in the heavens that does not fail, where no thieves approach nor moths destroy. For where your treasures are, there your heart will be also. For wherever your treasures are, there is where your heart will be also. And that is the message for today. Is that wherever you store up for yourselves, that is where your heart is. Either give it all to God. Let God be the reason of it all. Like I said earlier, whatsoever you do it unto God. If you wake up, you wake up to God. If you go to sleep, you go to sleep to God. If you make a friend, you make a friend to God. If you find a job, you find the job to God. If you're able to pay this and pay that, you pay this and that for God. You make sure that everything you do is for God. Again, you don't have to say that in your whole life. Oh, this I'm doing for God and this I'm doing. No, you just have to know it. It's inside of you. The kingdom of God is within you. God will build you. God will show you and mold you. no matter what you're going through. The birds are taken care of. That means you're going to be taken care of. Because God is your source. Because you put God first. Because you make that money for God. Because you started that business for God. Because you were able to save that for God. Everything is for God. For where your heart is, that's where your... For where your treasures are, that's where your heart will be. If God is in your heart now, then when you go into the kingdom of God and into heaven, your heart will be with God. You don't have to be a scientist to know that God is real in your life. You don't need to know another book, Dr. Seuss or Dr. Phil, to know that there is a God in your life. There doesn't have to be a TV show that tells you there is no God in your life. There should be nothing on your phone that ever tells you that there is no God in your life. There should be nobody ever speaking out of their mouth telling you that there is no God in your life. For you to believe all that will be for you to be silly. And you're not silly here this morning or this evening or this day because you belong to God. And to belong to God means that you belong to the source that is bigger than you. They will point a finger at you. They can do that. But you belong to God, the source, the power, the OG, the most original there could have ever been. There ain't no famous person in this world that I look up to. They all eat like I do. They all poop like I do. They don't inspire me. God inspires me. Jesus inspires me. Yeah, they got some cool things that they do. Yeah, they run. They do these race cars that run like 300 miles an hour. That's cool. They can fly all these jets over the clouds and see the world. That's cool. But it doesn't inspire me like God. It doesn't inspire me like my creator. The creator of that airplane. See, the one that created, he's all right. He's cool. But it was God who put that thought in his brain. And his brain was able to achieve it. It was God. It's not the man's. Wherever your treasures are, that's where your heart will be. Let your treasures be with God. Let your treasures be with our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Let your treasure be in your Christianity. Let your treasure be in the man and the woman you are. A person of confidence, knowing that God is the source of your life. And yeah, you may mess up, but on earth as it is in heaven, God will promote an escape. God will promote a forgiveness of you in your heart. God will show you and shape you and mold you. You don't need YouTube to tell you something different. If you really want to get into the source of it all, this is it. It's in the Bible. The Bible will teach you of your current war systems. The Bible will teach you of your current children's rebelliousness. It'll teach you about the financial world and what's going on in your financial life. It'll teach you about your healthy life, what's going on with your body. It'll teach you about your friendships, your relationships with other people. This book will teach you about the phone that you hold in your hand. This book will teach you about the job that you have outside. This book will teach you just about everything, if not everything you need in life to be effective and to be prosperous. This book will teach you anything you need to know. And you always remember that. Because this word is alive. Amen. 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 It was a good message. Good message. And that was the title of the message. Luke chapter 12. Started in 11 with a few. And where your heart is, that's where your treasure is. So do it for God here this morning. Heavenly Father, we just come before you and we thank you for this time, Lord, to get into your word, God, and get closer to you, God. For your word tells us that you look after your word to perform it. That means the more your word that we know, the more you perform in our life, the more you put new batteries in our life, the more you put new energy in our life, the more you put more excitement in our life, God. Because we know your word, God, you will perform it. As I say, God, you said so, and you would put on your and get it, Lord, and show us how to get it, Lord. We thank you, God, for our friends, our family, for this church, God, for the time, Father, that we get into your word. We thank you, God. It's in Jesus' name, and we all say, amen. Amen.